On our desert island this week is the actress, entertainer, writer and traveller, Shirley Maclaine. Could you endure loneliness and isolation?
Oh, what I would not be able to endure is being without isolation. Really need it.
Do you play discs a lot?
Yes.
You have this problem of taking just eight that may have to last for a long, long time. What did you have in mind when you started to choose?
What I could fit into an hour about choosing, because I have a hard time making up my mind.
So this is today's choice, but...
Yes, it definitely, if you would ask me next Thursday, I think it would be different.
What's the first one we're having today?
The first one is Fly Me to the Moon, Nat King Cole.
Why do you choose that?
Well, it's a love song that has to do with sort of the conglomeration of thinking of fantasy and reality. In other words, when you're really in love, you are flung to the stars.
Fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, darling, kiss me.
Fly Me to the Moon by Nat King Cole with the George Shearing Quintet. Whereabouts in the United States are you from, Shirley?
I am from Richmond, Virginia, the state of five presidents, Mason-Dixon line, sort of culturally adept and socio-politically motivated.
Yes.
Middle class.
Maclean is your middle name, isn't it?
It's my mother's maiden name and my middle name, yes. Mm-hmm. Scotch-Irish.
Which side is which?
Both. Little right. of each sprinkled in there. Mom was Canadian.
Now, you've reported that your home life was quiet and uneventful. How did you seek your escape from that as a child?
Mostly through dancing.
Mm-hmm.
I loved music. I loved getting on the bus and looking at people. It was a form of physical expression that I could use my body with. I felt very adept at doing it from a very, very early age. I mean, I can remember moving with a sense of consciousness about my movement when I was 1 year old.
Did there seem any possibility that this would be your profession, your vocation?
My mother told me that when I was about two, that I had begun to talk about all I wanted to be was a little dancing girl.
You had a very fierce dedication. There was one time when you danced the fairy godmother in Cinderella with a broken ankle in agony.
Oh, no, actually, I didn't feel it until after. But I was warming up before the performance, and I did a grand jeté across the stage, and I landed, and my right ankle buckled under me, and the bone cracked, and it went right through my toe shoe ribbon.
Wow.
Yeah, and I looked down and thought, well, I better get up again and keep going. It's not happening. And I really applied my first application of mind over matter. I was about 12.
How long were you laid up?
Oh, a few months.
Mm-hmm.
But I was back walking and dancing again soon after that. I didn't, I let it mend, but then I didn't think it was right to let it rust.
Right. Well, you'd gone as far as you could in Virginia. What was the next step?
I went to New York when I was about 16 and got into my first Broadway show by telling them I was 21.
Had you any contacts in New York?
No. Just knew where the airport was.
So it's up and down agency stairs until you found something.
Oh, I couldn't even get out of the agent's elevators in the beginning. Much less a producer's elevator.
And you had to find money for class every day and room rent.
Yes, my mom and dad financed that for me. I really didn't like taking it because I wanted to be on my own from the moment I left home, but I've been forever grateful for that.
Your very first job was in a sales presentation, wasn't it?
The very first job was in the subway circuit of Oklahoma, famous Broadway musical, and
yes.
We used to go around theaters in the outlying districts of Manhattan, and it was called the subway circuit. I was 16. The one you're referring to is an industrial show that I did after I graduated from high school, and I danced around Surville refrigerators for about a year. My job was to do pirouettes and fouettes until the ice was cold. And one day I got so upset with this job that I blacked out my two front teeth.
Continuing to do your fouettes.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Sold more refrigerators that week than anything on the whole circuit.
But they slung you out.
Oh, yeah, they fired me.
Let's have your second record. What's that to be?
That would be Vladimir Ashkenazy's Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto No. 1.
Why do you choose it?
I love the romantic sweep of the Russian soul, played by a 5'3" Russian who's very handsome with lots of hair, Roy.
Right, thank you. Yes. Vladimir Ashkenazy, playing an excerpt from the Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto No. 1 in B-flat minor with the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Lorin Marcel. So, you were on the subway circuit in Oklahoma and you did your sales presentation. What was your first Broadway show?
That was my first Broadway show, but then after that, I did... there's a famous summer theater in the round. I don't know if it still exists, but it was called St. John Terrell's Music Circus, and I did about 7 Broadway shows, a lot of on-the-job training, mm-hmm. at which time I did Kiss Me, Kate, Carousel, Guys and Dolls, all the wonderful classical American musicals.
Yes. And what was your first appearance on Broadway itself?
In the first full-fledged Broadway show was Rodgers and Hammerstein's Me and Juliet. Mm-hmm.
That never played in London.
No, it shouldn't have played in Broadway either. It wasn't that good.
You were in the chorus.
I was in the chorus, and that was when I first met my beloved Oscar Hammerstein. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful man he was, like a huge bear, so kind and so compassionate.
And then the pajama game. Now, that's where you got your big chance. You were understudy to Carol Haney.
Mm-hmm. But not until the night before we opened in New York. Because she was a gypsy like I. She would have gone on with a broken neck, seemingly. But she broke her ankle.
Well, you'd been on with a broken ankle.
Mm-hmm. That's how I knew she would. So I thought it would be impossible for me ever to go on. And the very night... she broke her ankle on a matinee performance day. And I had come home from the theater that day as a member of the chorus, very depressed that I would be in another hit musical in the chorus. And I didn't know what to do. In the meantime, they had asked me to replace the understudy for Gwen Verdon in Can Can. And I had my notice in my pocket to turn in to the producers of Pajama Game, who were Hal Prince, Bobby Griffith, Bob Fosse, et cetera,
yes.
Jerry Robbins. I was on my way to the theater. The subway got stuck in Times Square. I was late for even my part in the chorus, a half an hour. They finally got the subway door open, and I went screaming and running down 44th Street to the stage door, and there were Fosse and Hal Prince and the rest of them lined up against the stage door saying, "Where in the hell have you been?" And I said, "Well, the subway got stuck, but really it's not like the Third World War is going to happen because I'm not here." And they said, "Well, Carol Haney is out, and you're on for her." And I had never had a rehearsal.
No understudy rehearsals at all.
Mm-mm.
You were thrown straight on.
Mm-hmm. But I had studied it from the wings.
Yes.
And learned steam heat sort of by myself, doing the trick with the hat by myself.
Mm-hmm.
But I had never heard my own voice on the stage before because I was basically just a dancer expressing myself through the physical movement, but never with my voice. And that's the thing that scared me the most, how it would sound, both singing and speaking.
Yes.
You know, the audience didn't frighten me the first night. It was the cast lined up in the wings wondering if they would take me away in a cart or something. I have always been confident that I could razzle-dazzle the people, but I knew that they knew better, the cast in the show. But they were so supportive and nourishing to me. And then when the show was over, I walked on for... You see, the people who did Steam Heat together, of which the little character I was playing was one, three of us would come on and take a bow. And I came on with the other two dancers, and they separated away from me, as did the rest of the cast, and left me alone on the stage to take the bows from the audience. I was 18 years old, and I wasn't used to being a soloist. I wasn't used to that kind of reception or to be singled out as somebody talented. I was used to being a soldier, which is what a chorus person is.
Right.
I got very embarrassed, and I didn't know what to do. And I said, come back, don't leave me alone out here. I thought, maybe I'm not ready to be a star.
Yeah! I got steam heat, I got steam heat, I got steam heat. But I need your love to keep away the cold. I got steam heat, I got steam heat, I got steam heat. But I can't get warm without your hand to hold. The radiator's hissing still, I need your kissing to keep me from freezing each night. I got a hot water bottle, but nothing I got will take the place of you holding me tight. I got steam heat, I got steam heat, I got steam heat, but I need your love to keep away the cold.
And almost immediately you signed a five-year Hollywood contract to Mr. Hal Wallace.
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't give you your first film. What was that?
My first film was with Alfred Hitchcock. I went through the summer. Carol came back to the show, and I went back into the chorus for the summer, and she was out again in September with laryngitis. She couldn't talk. I went on again, and Hitchcock was in the audience, and he saw me and offered me a film. I had already been under contract to Wallace. They made an arrangement, and I went to work in Hollywood.
How did you get on with Hitchcock?
Oh, I adored him. I adored him. He had a very sort of laconic Cockney sense of humor, and I didn't really understand it.
The movie, of course, was The Trouble with Harry.
Mm-hmm.
You had by now married. Do you remember how much you and your husband had between you when you arrived in Hollywood?
About 35 cents, literally.
Mm.
Had to borrow money to rent a broken-down car. And then I made some money on the next picture.
Yes.
And soon after that, he went to Japan.
Now, you made The Trouble with Harry, Artists and Models, Around the World in 80 Days. None of them really money spinners. In other words, your career didn't take off with a wham right at the beginning.
No, it was a slow, gradual process. Well, 80 Days was a big hit, though. But it wasn't because I was in it, for sure.
Yes.
I wondered if I'd ever work again after that performance. Me as a Hindu princess is a little bit much.
Which movie was the turning point?
Some Came Running.
That was the one in which you became the only female member of the celebrated clan that was later to include Sinatra, Sammy Davis, Dean Martin, and all the rest of the boys.
But I had already made a film with Dean. I had made Artists and Models with Dean and Jerry.
Yes, yes.
Which we were reminding each other of a few months ago because we just did another film together. We worked together 30 years ago. Oh, well, you think you're old.
When you were a small child.
When you were already 80.
Charming, thank you.
Yes.
Will you see Miss Maclaine out of the studio, please?
To love and be loved, that's what life's all about. Keeps the stars coming out. What makes a sad heart sing? The birds take wing. To love and be loved, that's what living is for. Makes me want you the more we cling. Let others race to the moon, through time and space to the moon. My goal is greater than this, to reach your lips, to share your kiss, to stay in your arms is the dream I pursue. To be sheltered and safe from the storm, to be cozy and ever so warm, and for always to love and be loved by you.
You made some really good movies, Two for the Seesaw, The Apartment, Children's Hour. Which others do you like to remember?
Those, Irma, La Douce.
Yes.
God, I have to have a list of my movies because it seems like another life.
Well, never mind. We got four good ones. Let's move on to another record. And what's that to be?
This would be Blowin' in the Wind by Peter, Paul, and Mary. And I like it because of the social consciousness it has underneath the song, that there is something in the wind of change and how much longer will we have to go on destroying ourselves, but that the winds of change are blowing.
How many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Peter, Paul, and Mary, Blowing in the Wind. You are making all these successful pictures, Shirley, for various producers, but because of your contract with Mr. Hal Wallace, he was getting most of the money.
He was getting all of the money, if you really want my version of it.
That had to be sorted out.
Yeah, let me tell you what really it was, and this would even days of inflation horrify you. He was selling me out to other studios under this contract for, oh, I think at one point he could get $750,000 for me, and I got $6,000. I was getting less than the gopher on the set who went for coffee. So you know what I used to do? Whenever there was an early call, which I hate, you know, I don't stop coughing until 12 noon, and we have to show up as women do because they have makeup and hair to do. I would come and I would know the shot that was planned for the early morning, and I would only make up that side of my face that was in the camera. I used to piss him off so badly. He would come down and fume and fume and fume. I would say, give me the other 700,000, I'll make up the other side of my face.
You did eventually sort it out.
Yeah, I sued him.
You walked in the joint, I could see you were a man of distinction, a real big spender, good looking, so refined. Say, wouldn't you like to know what's going on in my mind? So let me get right to the point. I don't pop my cork for every guy I see. Hey, big spender! Spend a little time with me. How about a few laughs? I can show you a good time. Do you wanna have fun? Fun, fun.
How's about a few
fun laughs? Fun,
laughs,
fun,
laughs.
I can show you a fun
laughs. Good time.
Fun.
What do you say to her?
Hey, how's about a
laugh? I could give you some.
Are you ready for some
fun?
How would you like a
let me show you a
good time?
Hey, big spender! Joint. I could see you were a man of distinction, a real big spender, good looking, so refined. Wouldn't you like to know what's going on in my mind? So let me get right to the point. I don't pop my cork for every guy I see.
How about it, palsy?
Yeah.
You didn't like to be fooled around with. There's a story that you dared publicly beat up one of Hollywood's top show business columnists when he was writing some nasty stuff.
I didn't beat him up. I just slugged him.
Well, a fine distinction.
Mm. But I called my attorney first and asked what constituted assault and battery, because I didn't want to go to court over that. And he told me, well, if you slug somebody with the fist closed, that's assault and battery. But if you really let him have it with an open fist, you're just a woman who's very upset. That's what I did.
So he couldn't do a thing?
Oh, he was stunned. He was stunned. I remember I got a call from Hedda Hopper, who was alive in those days, very much alive. And she called me and she said, Shirley, I'm most upset with you. I said, oh, really? Why? She said, why didn't you kill the son of a bitch?
You took great care, I'm sure you still do, in researching the characters you played. When you played Irma in Irma La Douce. You spent time in Paris researching the professional life of tarts to really get the right feel of it.
Mm. I enjoyed the research so much I nearly gave up the acting.
What was the name of your technical advisor?
Oh, there were many. Lots of girls. They were very sweet, very interesting, confused women, and mm-hmm. I became rather involved with why they thought they had to become prostitutes.
Yes.
And it had to do with lots of psychological damage done early in their lives.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's a long story, though, a really long story.
Yes, surely. But they knew what you were doing, what your motives were,
and
they,
sure.
they cooperated.
Oh, yes, because I wanted to portray it, at least emotionally, as honestly as I could. Mm-hmm. We couldn't put what really goes on the screen, of course, but the stuff that Billy used, I mean, the credit card jokes and some of the fantasies that some men liked. There were some cabinet ministers who would visit the women and leave the motors in their cars running because they didn't have time. You know, they had some emergency session to return to. I mean, lots of stuff like that. And so I told Billy all that, and he put it in the movie.
Let's have record number four. What have we got next?
This is Andrew Lloyd Webber's Song and Dance, and it's the second part called Variations, which I absolutely adore.
You've seen the London production, have
mm-hmm.
you?
And one day I would like to do something to Variations. It's really remarkable.
An excerpt from Variations from Andrew Lloyd Webber's Song and Dance, the orchestra conducted by Harry Rabinovich. As a Hollywood star, Shirley, you were as big as they come, but the Hollywood you knew was on the skids.
Well, you're talking about the years when the star system went out and
yes.
the Hollywood contracts were more or less disbanded.
Things were beginning to collapse.
Yeah, it became the age of the independent producer and stars were more or less on their own. I was one of the last who had the advantage of being nurtured and alternately exploited by the star system.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, I think the lawsuit that I brought against Hal Wallace was the beginning of the fall of it. Because, you see, mine was a 5-year contract, and under the California statute of limitations, it can't go any longer than 5, but he stretched it to 7. When I had my baby, he extended it. Every time he loaned me out for a picture, he extended it. So I sued him under that California statute of limitations.
And you won.
Yeah.
If you start at the top, you're certain to drop. You gotta watch your timing. Better begin by climbing. Up, up, up the ladder. If you're going to last, you can't make it fast, man. Nobody starts a winner. Give me a slow beginner. Easy does it, my friend. Conserve your fine endurance. Easy does it, my friend. Boy, that's your life insurance. While you young, take it rung after rung after rung. It's not where you start, it's where you finish. It's not how you go, it's how you land. That 100-to-1 shot, the one who's a klutz can outrun the favorite. All he needs is the guts. Your final return will not diminish. And you can be the cream of the crop. It's not where you start, it's where you finish. And you're gonna finish on top.
It's not where you start, It's where you finish.
That's right. It's not where you were, it's where
it's
you
not
are.
Where you were, it's where
you're
you are.
You're stuck in the mail room, just gathering moss. Then pow, comes the memo that you now are the boss. Supposing your ear is kinda tinnish. Let everybody cringe when you croon. It's not where you start, it's where you finish. And you're gonna finish in tune.
You moved into a big international television setup, but that was a mistake.
Colossal. Mm. I didn't like the creative people working on it. I didn't like the scripts. I knew it would be a disaster. I called my agent before we began and said, this is never going to work. The stories aren't good. It's not real. I really think we should postpone it for a year until we get it into some sort of shape. Or else forget about it. But I was told I'd be sued for something like $18 million because the airtime had been bought and the sponsors had been committed, etc. So I had to go through with it.
So the next step was your one-woman stage show.
Well, I went through about 3 or 4 years of political involvement.
Yes.
And that was very important to me. I worked for George McGovern, anything to keep Nixon from being president because of what he would do to the Supreme Court and how he would, totalitarianize the American government, and that's indeed what happened, and the Americans threw him out. But I worked for 2 years straight and sort of knowed myself out of the business. Whenever they would call me to invite me to make a film, I would say, no, I'm busy with politics, and I think people thought that I didn't want to work anymore. I began to write around that period, my first book, Don't Fall Off the Mountain, and then my second book when I was invited to go to China with the...
You've always had this travel bug right from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
You've lived with the Maasai. You've been in remote areas of the Himalayas. You've explored India. And Japan literally has been a second home to you ever since you were married.
Mm-hmm.
You took a delegation of, I quote, regular, unquote, American women to communist China. Now, this was a serious trip, but it must have been rather hilarious.
Oh. It was hilarious. If anything is regular, of course, I don't know where that description came from. What I tried to do was make a fair cross-section of women. I took a camera crew of 4 feminists. And then how do you say what is a regular American? A regular American can be a Native American, an Indian, or a Puerto Rican, or a rich Boston Brahmin, or a 12-year-old girl, or a, you know. I tried to do the best I could because I could only take 12 people. But it was hilarious. We learned more about ourselves as Americans than we did about China.
Thank you. let's have record number five.
All right. This would be Nat King Cole's Nature Boy, which I adore. It's been one of my favorite songs because of the mellowness of his voice since I was about early teens. And I love what it says.
There was a boy, a very strange, enchanted boy. They say he wandered very far, very far, over land and sea. A little shy and sad of eye.
Nature Boy, Nat King Cole. Shirley, your first book, Don't Fall Off the Mountain, began as a conventional show business biography, but then it switched to your travels and matters which trouble your social conscience. And mm-hmm. quite a lot of things trouble your social conscience.
Yes, my dad always used to say I had a missionary complex worrying too much about the underdog. And then when I would ask him, well, who would worry about them, he was stuck because he really was not a conservative thinker. For example, like Ronald Reagan, who would say, well, where there's a will, there's a way, you won't be an underdog. That's sort of Horatio Alger thinking. But what I did in my travels was recognize how many starving, deprived people there were in the world, and it really touched me.
Can get there from here. A great deal about politics in that book.
Mm-hmm.
And then your new one, Out on a Limb, a very personal book, a great deal about your metaphysical beliefs and discoveries.
Mm-hmm. That to me is the most evolved, how shall I say, extension of my search for identity. Because that's, after all, what I think I've been doing all these years. I think I was a dancer, a singer, an actress, a person who felt comfortable in comedy and comfortable in tragedy and comfortable in writing because I was trying to know who I was. And I think that's the reasons for all my love affairs, all my relationships with people I've met around the world. I feel comfortable everywhere because everywhere I go, I almost feel I've been there. And I think it began seriously in India when I felt, oh, this is just too familiar for words. I know I've been here before. I began to explore my own feelings, my own intuitive intelligence about the feeling of always going home to each country that I traveled to. And I think that was probably what was going on. I think I felt motivated to visit these places again, hopefully to listen and resonate to my sort of inner voice that Thoreau would talk about.
Let's get back to music.
This would be Tony Bennett singing Lost in the Stars, the Wilder piece, since I'm so interested in the feeling of where one fits in the cosmos. This has always appealed to me, and it's a very comfortingly sad, yet haunting lyric. I love the lyric.
And we're lost out here in the stars.
Tony Bennett, Lost in the Stars. Let's get back to the desert island again. You must have picked up enough information on your travels to look after yourself pretty well if you were completely isolated. Could you build some kind of shelter?
When you say desert island, couldn't I make my own desert island? Because I think that I can make anything I want to about my surroundings and my desires.
That's fair enough, providing it's a deserted island,
mm-hmm.
and it hasn't anything too elaborate in the way of natural resources. It's all yours. You pick your own. What part of the world would you like it in?
Probably the South Pacific.
Mm-hmm.
There would be lots of fruit trees, mango trees, papayas,
yes.
Bananas, lemons and oranges, etc.
Would you fish as well, or would you be a fruitarian?
I'd be a fruitarian, I think. And I'd have a couple of nut bushes around.
Yes, yes, that's good.
To match me.
Would you try to escape?
Oh, no. I'd try to keep everyone who tried to land out. It's my idea of paradise, to be on a desert island with plenty of juicy stuff to eat. And I would like to take one thing.
What's that?
1 ton of blank paper and lots of rolling pens.
Right. I was going to ask you to choose one luxury to take, so you've chosen that. So that's taken care of.
Mm.
Let's have... I think it's your 7th record now.
This is Tchaikovsky, Swan Lake. It reminds me of my classical hard work, education, dedication, beauty, romanticism, discipline, lyricness, sweat, and my childhood of physical expression.
Well, we'll give you half a ton of ballet shoes as well.
My feet are so big, that's only going to be one shoe.
An excerpt from Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake Ballet, played by the Moscow Radio Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Roj Desvensky. And now we come to your last record. What's that to be?
Well, my last record is my own.
Yes.
I love my song, my theme song, If My Friends Could See Me Now. Because
mm-hmm.
that's about the way I feel every time I think about what I'm doing now and what my friends might think about it.
This is a number you always include in your one-woman show.
Mm-hmm. I love the arrangement. Cy Coleman did an arrangement to it that's wonderful. He wrote the original song.
Yeah.
It's from Sweet Charity, but Cy Coleman adapted it for me in my one-woman show. And it makes me feel good. And hopefully the audience.
If they could see me now, that little dusty group, traipsing around this million-dollar chicken coop, I'm rubbing elbows with the cream of the crop. Whoever said there ain't no room at the top. All I can say is wow. Down with the riff and raff, up with the upper half. What a step up. They'd never believe it if my friends could see me now.
Your own recording from your one-woman show of If My Friends Could See Me Now, from Sweet Charity. How many countries have you performed your one-woman show?
Oh, dear. All through Europe, Scandinavia, so that must be 10 or 11 right there, Australia, Mexico, Canada.
If you could take only one disc, which one would you choose?
Probably my own. Mm-hmm. It would make me feel good, like it does every time I sing it.
And you've already chosen the one luxury you would take. That's all that blank paper to write another book. Choose one printed book. We'll give you the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare as a basic ration.
I really don't like choosing one because I really find that too limiting. Roy, I don't want to choose just one.
All right. Well, you can have a dictionary so that whatever you write...
Oh, that's a good idea.
...can be spelled
I would take
correctly.
Yes. I would have a dictionary with Roger's thesaurus so that I could fill up the ton of blank pages with help with cross-references in English. But I would like the thesaurus to be translated into every language, so I would make plans before I went.
Every language?
Mm-hmm.
There wouldn't be room on the island. I'll give you 6 thesauruses in 6 languages. That should get you through, shouldn't it?
In a new tongue to pronounce it.
Thank you, Shirley Maclaine, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you.
Goodbye, everyone.